Hi there. Are you tuning into Church at Home for the first time? Maybe a friend or family member invited you. Maybe you found us online. Or maybe you clicked on this by accident. No matter how you came to church today, we believe it is no coincidence you're here. And we would love to connect with you. Head to our website to find out who we are. Join a life group to experience connection like never before. Jump on our social media to keep up to date with the life of our church. Or fill out a next steps form so that our team can reach out to you during the week. We can't wait to meet you.
At Encompass, giving our tithes and offerings is not just a biblical command. It is our privilege and our part to play in building God's kingdom. If you are new to giving, we want to let you know that now all of our giving is online. But there's still more than one way to give. Head to our website for credit card, direct deposit or BPAY options, or give via our Encompass Church app.
Hi there. Are you tuning into Church at Home for the first time? Maybe a friend or family member invited you. Maybe you found us online. Or maybe you clicked on this by accident. No matter how you came to church today, we believe it is no coincidence you're here. And we would love to connect with you. Head to our website to find out who we are. Join a life group to experience connection like never before. Jump on our social media to keep up to date with the life of our church. Or fill out a next steps form so that our team can reach out to you during the week. We can't wait to meet you.
At Encompass, giving our tithes and offerings is not just a biblical command. It is our privilege and our part to play in building God's kingdom. If you are new to giving, we want to let you know that now all of our giving is online. But there's still more than one way to give. Head to our website for credit card, direct deposit or BPAY options, or give via our Encompass Church app.
Hi there. Are you tuning into Church at Home for the first time? Maybe a friend or family member invited you. Maybe you found us online. Or maybe you clicked on this by accident. No matter how you came to church today, we believe it is no coincidence you're here. And we would love to connect with you. Head to our website to find out who we are. Join a life group to experience connection like never before. Jump on our social media to keep up to date with the life of our church. Or fill out a next steps form so that our team can reach out to you during the week. We can't wait to meet you.
At Encompass, giving our tithes and offerings is not just a biblical command. It is our privilege and our part to play in building God's kingdom. If you are new to giving, we want to let you know that now all of our giving is online. But there's still more than one way to give. Head to our website for credit card, direct deposit or BPAY options, or give via our Encompass Church app.
Hi there. Are you tuning into Church at Home for the first time? Maybe a friend or family member invited you. Maybe you found us online. Or maybe you clicked on this by accident. No matter how you came to church today, we believe it is no coincidence you're here. And we would love to connect with you. Head to our website to find out who we are. Join a life group to experience connection like never before. Jump on our social media to keep up to date with the life of our church. Or fill out a next steps form so that our team can reach out to you during the week. We can't wait to meet you.
I'm not afraid to Hey church, Tom here. Now I know we've been going through some pretty bizarre times, and since we're going to be indoors for a little while longer, Linda and I thought we would share with you some hot tips to having an epic church experience right in your homes.
That's right, Tom. We know it can be a little bit hard to engage with the service being online, but we're going to help you lean in and draw closer to our church family this season.
Be sure to wake up early. You don't want to be falling asleep during the service.
Plus, waking up early means having enough time for the important things. I prefer to dress for comfort.
So your home feels more like church. Hey Legion, come in. Welcome to church at home. So good to have you, mate. Come through, front row seat. Worship has just started. Take a seat.
Tip 5, avoid any distractions.
Oops. Whoa, that's so good, Pastor. Let me write that down. Wow. Well, church, that's all from us. We hope you enjoyed and you're able to apply our tips into your church at home experience. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. into church? Who's ready to praise the name of Jesus with us this morning? You know, in the song we're about to sing, it says, wherever God is, there's freedom, there's victory, and there's breakthrough. Come on, let's choose to be free in the presence of God this morning. Let's choose to lift the name of Jesus on high. You are here. As we lifting up your name, lifting up your name, you are here. Giving you the praise, giving you the praise. The kingdom of God is released in this atmosphere. With freedom and breakthrough and victory are right here. 'Cause where you are is where I wanna be, in your presence. And there's no place that I would rather be. Jesus, it's heaven on earth. It's heaven on earth. It's heaven on earth. It's heaven on trust in what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do.
Your glory.
Good is it just to be in the presence of God and worship Him? Come on, in this moment of worship, in this atmosphere of faith, why don't you stretch your hands to heaven? Let's believe for an open heaven, you know, over our service this morning. You know, I want to encourage you with a verse from Acts 2. You know, this is a time when the followers of Jesus, they were in hiding. You know, they were afraid for their lives. You know, they were in lockdown, a little bit like us. And in Acts 2:2, it says, suddenly, get that word in your spirit this morning, suddenly, a sound like a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house. You know, suddenly there was revival. Suddenly there was an outpouring that changes everything. You know, whatever your need is this morning, I don't know about you, but I'm desperate for heaven to intervene in my situations, in my world, you know, in my state. Whatever your need is, you know, maybe it's a prayer request for healing, for restoration, breakthrough over strongholds and addiction, whatever it is, why don't you stretch your hands to heaven and let's pray together. Let's believe for God to move, for power of God to move powerfully this morning. God, I thank you for your presence. Thank you that you are here with us. You are with every household, every person tuning into this service. Lord God, I pray for your suddenlies to take place. You know, right now we are believing for chains to be broken, strongholds to be broken, Lord God, healing to take place, Lord God. We pray this in faith. I thank you for your power, the all-surpassing power of Jesus, Lord God. And I pray, Lord God, for our state, you know, for the situation that we're in, for this lockdown, God. Intervene, Lord God. Do what only you can do, you know, make a way for us, Lord God. You are a miracle working God. I pray for every heart that are discouraged, you know, that's disappointed, that's feeling sad, Lord God. I pray that your joy would come, Lord God, and it would change everything. I thank you, Lord God, that there's just freedom and there's just your faith in your presence, Lord God. We give you all the glory, all the honor and praise. We thank you for all the things that you've done for us and all the things you're about to do. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and all the people say amen. What do you type amen, amen on the amen. Chat? You know what? You say amen out loud. Welcome to church. Bill, how
hey,
you doing?
Dita. Hey, Dita, what a powerful prayer that was. You know, it's an honor to be here today. I feel so pumped that I'm in the house of God.
So good.
You know, even though there's not a lot of people around, there's only a few of us, but just thinking out, you know, how many people are normally around. And,
yeah.
You know, I was just speaking to Dee the other day, and I was just saying to her, you know, how much I miss being at church, you know, how much I miss seeing
That's right,
people
yeah.
and their faces. You know, massive shout out to all the guest services teams and kids ministry, worship team, all the teams.
Fusion Humans, shout out.
Massive shout out to everyone. You know, it's such a pleasure to be here today.
Yeah.
And it's so good. Like, you know, I'm pumped. I'm excited. So we just want to warmly welcome you this morning on behalf of Pastor John and Pastor Lois. You know, we're so excited that you're tuned in, that you're on.
That's
you're
right.
here with us. We are stoked. So we're just absolutely wrapped. If you're new to church, you know, and we can't wait to meet you. You know, we can't wait to connect with you. You know,
yeah.
we're so looking forward to it. You know, in the chats, they're going to post out in a minute, you know, with links on how you can get connected, you know, via a Next Steps link. You know, please fill it out.
That's
please
right.
let
yep.
us know who you are. We want to connect with you. For existing members of the church, you know, if you want to get involved in a life group, and even new people as well, you want to get involved in a life group, prime opportunity for you to do so via the app as well.
That's right.
And also, if you want to serve, you know, how
yep.
good is serving during this season?
Love serving, you know, even though it's COVID season, we can still serve online. I love how there's always something to do at church and we want you to be part of our team.
Yeah,
you know?
Amen. Amen. Get involved. Jump on board. That's
right.
what we want. What are we doing now, Dita?
We are doing the news. A lot of things are happening in the life of our church. So why don't we watch Encompass News? Check it out.
Thank you to our youth and young adults who joined us for part one and two of Conversations 2.0 with Pastor Elise Murphy and Pastor Blake Young. We still have one more conversation to go, and this one is for the whole church. Pastor Mark Varughese will be joining us on Sunday, the 18th of October at 7:30 p.m. to share about how we as a church can work together in our preparation to return to face-to-face services. There is still time to register, so head to the Encompass Church website today.
Hey church, we have pulled, stretched, changed, shifted, and are so excited to announce our brand new three-part e-experience course. Whether you're new to Encompass Church or whether you've been connected with us for a while, e-experience is for anyone who is keen to explore who we are as a church, what your spiritual gifts and passions are, and how you can use them to serve in the church and in the world. Register via the Encompass website to join Pastor John and Pastor Mark for our first e-experience session starting on Sunday the 25th of October at 11 a.m. via Zoom. Even if you've completed some parts of e-experience in the past but haven't finished the whole course, that's okay, you can complete it with us online. Every registration will also go into the draw to win an Uber Eats voucher. We can't wait to get to know you and for you to get to know us.
A reminder to all our Encompass Church partners that our AGM is on today at 12:10 p.m. Join us straight after the 11 a.m. service. Watch out for a text message with the link.
Hey, how good was that? You know, I want to highlight two things today. Tonight we have Pastor Mark Varughese from Kingdom City to wrap up our Conversations 2.0. It's been awesome having so many different guest speakers on Zoom. So this is one of those events that you don't want to miss out. You know, Pastor Mark is an incredible high caliber leader, and you're going to want to hear what he has to say about teamwork and unity this COVID season. So if you are not yet registered, go to encompass.org.au right now and get yourself there tonight. Would love to see your faces. Okay, and exciting thing, next week e-experience is back, you know, and we're taking it online. It's just the best way for you to connect and get to know our church, the values, the vision. You know, so if you are new, this is perfect for you. If you've been coming to our church the last couple of months, please get yourself registered, as you've seen in the news before. You know, you get to know our team and you get to get equipped for life as well. So do that. All right, so now we're going to come into the time of giving. Why don't you share your thought, Bill?
Yeah, that's so good, Dita. You know, getting involved in e-experience and also getting onto Conversations with Mark Varughese. So looking forward to it. Just wanted to say to you guys, if you're new to church or if you're new to giving, you know, you can visit our website. Just hop onto our website, check it out. And there's also going to be a link posted in the chat to give. Yep. Click on that and you can find out more ways about how you can give. So I just wanted to share a thought with you this morning, you know, about, you know, how faithful God is and how good He is, even during a season of lack.
Yeah.
You know, many years ago, I left real estate and I was sort of left wondering, you know, I didn't have a job, you know, didn't have something to go to, you know, was working on a couple of ideas with work and with businesses and things like that. But one thing remained for Dee and I, and that was that we continuously gave God first. You know, gave everything that we had first to Him before we gave to anything else. You know, and even during this season of lockdown, you know, with COVID and so on, you know, we've still managed to do the same thing. You know, wow. So many people have lost work and, you know, the ability to earn income and things like that. Even with myself, heading back into real estate, you know, having roadblockers, you know, but one thing's just remained true, and that is we've just kept giving to God, wow. No matter what the circumstances have been in our life. You know, and it talks about in God's word, you know, in Proverbs 3:9-10, it says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with your first fruit of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine.
Right.
Man, I love that scripture, you know, talking about honoring God and our vats will brim over. And our, you know, our storehouses will overflow. You know, that's the goodness of God.
Yeah, so
you know, He's so good to us. You know, He makes such a way for us to be able, when we give to Him, He gives back and it's an overflow.
Yeah,
I want to be in that. Don't you, Dita?
Yeah,
I want to be in the overflow. I want to be able to give to God. You know, and I also want, you know, us to have enough to be able to give away. You know, God loves a cheerful giver.
That's right.
And that's what it's all about. You know, so I encourage you today, and I also challenge you to put God first in your finances.
Yeah,
put Him in the rightful place that He belongs. You know, without Him, nothing is possible, but with Him, everything is
that's
possible.
Right.
So we thank You, Father God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You, Father God, that You give us the ability to earn income.
Yeah,
we thank You, Father God, that, you know, You make a way where ways don't seem possible, Father God. We thank You, Lord, for giving us the ability to be able to give to others, Lord.
Yeah.
And we thank You, Lord, that, you know, when we overflow onto others.
Yes.
So we thank You, Jesus, for everything that You do for us, everything You're about to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So where are we up to, Dita?
We are introducing our preacher for today.
Preacher, our pastor, very own pastor, Jason Newcastle.
Pastor Jace.
Are so stoked that you are going to be delivering the message today. Pastor Jace is just such an amazing man of faith.
Yeah.
You know, with conviction, you know, he's an amazing friend. Why don't you all light up the chat welcome him to the what?
To the platform.
To the platform. Welcome, Pastor Jace.
Hey, and welcome to Encompass. My name is Jason, and I'm part of the team here at Encompass Church. We want to warmly welcome you here today. Listen, we know today is Sunday, and Sundays are sometimes odd in Victoria in particular, because I guess we know at this point today we're going to hear some news from our Premier, Daniel Andrews. And listen, we know it's probably not the news that we'd like to receive. It's probably not the news that we wanted and that we hoped for. But I just want to remind us all, as believers, we put our hope in Jesus Christ. And we just thank God that He is in control and on the throne. And I want to tell you that although things seem to be delayed right now, I want to tell you God is in control and God will have His way in this season. But I just believe this is a great time to pray. Let's commit ourselves and this state and the world to God right now. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank You, God, Lord, for what You've been doing in our lives over this season. And Lord God, we just commit ourselves to You right now. Anyone that is struggling with the news right now that we hear all the time, Lord, these numbers, this virus, God, Lord, we just commit this all to You. We leave it at Your feet. And we ask, God, Lord, that we receive peace and joy from You. Anyone that is struggling, that feels hopeless right now, Lord, I just pray a new hope is instilled in them this morning, God, Lord. Lord, we commit our Premier to You, their teams, God, Lord, their families, God. And I just pray that You give them the wisdom and discernment to lead us in this next season better than ever. God, Lord, we just speak against this virus in the name of Jesus. And we declare, God, Lord, Your power. Lord, let there be a miracle that takes place. Numbers will go down dramatically. And all we'll be able to say is, Lord, You were at work. This was a miracle from God. So God, Lord, we commit ourselves to You. We commit our church to You. We commit this state to You, this country and our world to You in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Hey, so listen, this morning I have the privilege of continuing and actually closing off the series, Essential Business. Who's enjoyed our series so far? Why don't you write in the chat if you've enjoyed it. If you didn't, obviously, don't write in the chat because we'll have it in writing and we'll screenshot it and we'll send it to you and we'll ask for feedback. But anyway, just playing with you. But anyway, we're closing off this series. And listen, we've heard some great messages, right? Pastor Mark, Pastor John, Pastor Lois have shared some incredible thoughts about the essential businesses, the spiritual practices that help us walk with Jesus. This is all about actually leading us to a better walk, a more intimate relationship with God. And today, instead of actually adding another spiritual discipline to your life, like instead of actually adding, I'm kind of going to go a bit rogue here. Like I'm going to go off topic and I'm not going to add another thing that you should do in your life. Today, I kind of want us to slow down a little bit. I want us to stop for a moment and I want to ask you a little bit of an uncomfortable question this morning. And that question this morning that I want to reflect on for myself, and I believe it's important that you reflect on as a person too, the question is, have you grown? Have you grown? And I don't mean grown like this or grown like this. I'm not Prince Paul either. Like, as in the thing is, have you grown in your life? And when I talk about this, the thing is that some of us can go, what do you mean by this? Like, I'm talking about, has something in your life transformed? Has something changed in your life where you're different? Has transformation taken place? Because here's the thing, God's desire for you is to grow. God's desire for your life. I'll be honest, as a church, as pastors and leaders here at Encompass Church, our hearts for you is to grow. And I believe that we should always be taking steps, but that's not always that easy. The thing is that some of you are thinking, oh, when they talk about these spiritual disciplines and practices, they must be just saying how to become they're teaching us how to become a professional Christian. And really, our hearts is not for you to get your rituals and religious activities right. I want to tell you this morning that our heart for you is that we believe that it is through these spiritual practices that you will get closer to God. It is actually through these spiritual practices that there is actually great freedom. There is healing. There is an intimacy with God. And I believe it actually leads to growth in God. I keep saying this word grow, right? Like, as in everyone's like going, he said grow like 44 times. And it's like the second part of the message. Like, it's 2 minutes in. But what do I mean by growth? I'm talking about spiritual maturity. What is spiritual maturity? Well, spiritual maturity is becoming more Christ-like, not in some things, but in all things, not in your personal preference. I'm going to apply the word here, but not here, but in every bit of Bible reference that we will become more like Christ. You see, most of the time, the problems that you and I face, the problems that you're going through right now with your family member, your work colleague, potentially the season that you're going through, it's actually because of spiritual immaturity, not maturity. You see, potentially you have a lack of patience, or you're struggling to forgive that family member that hasn't contacted you since COVID started. Potentially, you call it you're being careful with your money, but most people in your life would say you come across a little bit greedy at times. Potentially you're defensive and unapproachable. You know, the Bible speaks about spiritual maturity and growth. And I just want to read a few passages just to set up this message this morning. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, it says, therefore, let us move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward in maturity. Everyone say maturity. You know, Colossians 2, verse 6, it says, so then, just as you've received Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I love this next word. It says, continue to walk with him. Continue to live a life like Christ. Continue means don't stop. You haven't landed anywhere. Continue means to grow, to evolve, to take the next step. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, it says, then we will no longer be like immature children. Another version, the Phillips version, puts it like this. We are not to remain as children. We won't be tossed and blown away by every wind of new teaching. We will no longer be influenced when people try to trick us with smart-sounding truths that isn't actually the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth with love. That's spiritual maturity. Growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of the body. The Message version puts it very plainly. And if you're following this message so far, this is what God says in the Message version. It says, God wants you to grow up. That's how he says it. God wants you to grow up. Turn to your neighbor right now and tell him, hey, you need to grow up. Maybe don't. They might get offended because they haven't grown up yet. You know, you can be 25, you can be 45, you can be even 75, but actually never have grown up. You can actually still deal with things like a teenager. You know, I love Harley. For those of you that don't know who Harley is my 10-month-year-old daughter. She turned 10 months last Sunday, okay? And she's adorable. Like, I'm actually going to put up some photos now because some of you have not seen her for the last 7 months. But she's got two front teeth here. She is so cute. And I love this baby face. Like, you get to carry and stuff. Listen, while we've got her on screen, who thinks she looks like me? Who thinks she looks like Alyssa? Okay, we'll talk about this later. I was in a meeting with, I think it was Columba and Bettsmith, and they kept saying she looked like Alyssa. I wasn't offended. I just need to grow up a little bit. But anyway, but here's the thing. I digressed completely. But this is what I'm getting at here. With Harley being 10 months, and as much as I love the baby phase, it would be a tragedy if she just stayed as a baby. Do you know what I mean? It would be a tragedy if she never grew up. As her father, I want her to grow up. I want her to learn more about the English language and other languages if she wants. I want her to go to school. I want her to make friends. I want her to go get married even. And I'm going to give that guy a hard time. He's going to cop it from me. Like, as in, I want her to grow up and find her own relationship with God, serve God for herself. as her father, I want her to grow. And I want to tell you something, that's God's desire for you and I. God's desire for you and I is that we grow, that we mature, and that we move on. And so as we finish off this series of essential business, I want to talk about the essential business of growth, because it's essential. God wants you to move on and move past things. He wants you to trust Him and others like never before. He wants you to dream big. To the person at home just going, oh, COVID has just ruined my whole life. I want to tell you, He wants you to dream again. He wants you to dream big. He wants you to live a big life, but it requires you to grow, to embrace growth. Something actually has to shift in your life. Man, we should label a year shift. We've done that actually. Growth has to take place. So as I said, we've gone through the whole ideas of what you need to do, right? If you ever go through YouTube or podcast at Encompass Church, you're going to see like all the different topics we've ever covered on what you need to do. But today, I want to do something a little bit different. I want to talk about where you grow, not how you grow, not what you need to do, but what environments, where do you actually grow in? And I want to talk about two environments where you grow. But before I do that, this is what it says in Matthew chapter 13. Because here's the thing, just because you know something doesn't mean you grow. Just because you know does not mean you apply. A farmer went out to sow his seed. This is Matthew 13. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along a path and the birds came and ate it. No growth. And then some of the seeds fell along some soil with that was rocky. And so the plants grew, but then the sun came along and scorched it because it was so shallow that the roots couldn't take place. And then the sun scorches this plant. I reckon it's like the Japanese maple that is in our backyard in a pot right now. The roots are too shallow. So then it goes on to say that some seeds were planted and in thorny ground. And so the tree grows, but all of a sudden the plants are suffocated. But then we see in verse 8, it says, still other seeds fell on good soil. Everyone say good soil. Where it was produced, where it produced a crop 100, 60 or 30 times what was sown. I want to tell you, just because you've got a seed to sow doesn't mean growth is inevitable. It requires good soil. It requires a good environment. Let me tell you something, is that just because you go to church online every week, it could just mean that the word is going in one ear and out the other. You know, just because maybe you pray, it doesn't mean you have a personal relationship with God. It could just be out of religion and rituals that you're actually praying. You got to go, oh, no, but like, as in, I serve God. But you may have a really bad, stinky attitude. Like, it might be ridiculous how you serve, and that's actually not spiritual maturity. That is actually just spiritual activity. And there is a difference between the two. And I want to encourage you this morning that God wants us to spiritually mature, but it requires good soil. It requires a good environment. So let's go to the first environment where you will grow in. The first environment that you and I can grow in is an environment of conviction. Everyone say conviction. Conviction. You see, when we live lives that are open to the conviction of the Holy Spirit, there is growth. When you live a life that is convicted, that is open and soft towards the Holy Spirit, there is growth. I want to tell you, firstly, do not confuse conviction with condemnation. You see, conviction says God is with you. Conviction says God is going to help you. But condemnation says you're on your own. Shame on you for what you're doing. I want to tell you, conviction shows you the answer. Condemnation only shows you the problem. Right? Conviction helps you change. But this is what I want to tell you about condemnation. Condemnation says you are never going to change. You're always going to be the same. I want to tell you, God is not a God of condemnation. God is a God of conviction. He is here with you and ready to walk with you. It is through conviction that your direction and growth can take place. I want to tell you, there's a passage in Acts chapter 16, and it shows actually how Paul literally changes direction based on the words and the nudges from the Holy Spirit. It says Paul and his companion traveled throughout the region of Persia and Galatia, having been kept by the Holy Spirit. That's what it says. Having been kept by the Holy Spirit from preaching the word of God in province, When they came to the border of Mysia, they tried to enter Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus, another name for the Holy Spirit, would not allow them to. Here we have Paul that was on his way to Asia and ends up in Macedonia. Why? Because he had a softness towards the voice of the Holy Spirit. The voice of the Holy Spirit was saying, hey, you're not supposed to go here. You shouldn't say this here, and I need you to go over there. If you read on, there's visions and signs that Paul gets to actually change the direction that he is going in. You know, a few weeks ago, we did a night called I Need a Miracle, and we've been hearing testimonies for the last few weeks since then. But I want to tell you, I know of some people personally that were believing for spiritual, emotional, mental breakthroughs. I'm talking, they needed their life to be turned right around upside down. And I want to tell you, God came through, and it was the revelation of the Holy Spirit. It was the moments with the Holy Spirit of him revealing things, of him showing things. And I tell you, you talk to them a few days later, miracles took place where literally their lives were turned around. Why? Because they had a soft heart towards the Holy Spirit. That's where growth takes place, when we have conviction of the Holy Spirit. I think about myself over the years, and 10 years ago, I'd never read a book unless I was in year 12 for year 12. That's the only time I read a book. I think that book was called The Hatchet. I don't even know. Anyway, side note, real story. But realistically, when it comes to reading, 10 years ago, I was not a reader. And I'll never forget one year, I was asking God for a few things. And one of the things I asked God for was, God, would you give me wisdom? What a silly 10 years ago Jason I was. Anyway, I was like, God, would you give me wisdom? And all of a sudden, I felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And he says, hey, you want to be a great leader, but great leaders are readers, right? And I'm like, oh, no, but I'm one of those guys, I just don't read. You know what I mean? This is not my thing. I'll never forget feeling this conviction. I'll never forget that year I started to read one or two books in the year. And then the next year went on, I started to read 5-12 books in that year. And then now I would read books and books and books within months. And I surprised myself, because I was the guy that said I was not a reader, but took the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And him saying, something needs to change. You might go, that's pretty good. He gave you some wisdom and you found the self-motivation to read. Okay, let me give you something else. Recently in my devotional life, right, I was waking up, doing my devotions, doing my thing, and I felt God just say to me, hey, listen, I think you need to make a few tweaks in your devotions. I like what you're doing, but you need to add more layers. You need to add more things with me, and I need you to start preparing for something different right now. And I was like, oh, whoa. But it was the conviction of the Holy Spirit that I was able to apply change to my life straight away. Straight away, I'll never forget, that night he spoke to me. The next morning I woke up and I was like in fight mode. I'm like, oh man, this is changing. I'm doing this. Let's go. Do you know what I mean? Like, as in something changed. Why? Because my heart, it was good soil. It was soft enough to be convicted by the Holy Spirit, and change took place. How many of you know that, if you don't know, I'm Indian. I'm not Sri Lankan, not Mauritius, or those other nationalities. I'm Indian, Virat Kohli, all the way. But here's the thing, my mum, also Indian, makes sense, but she kind of gave me some feedback recently. Who knows that mum's feedback is never... I don't want her feedback. But anyway, she raised a thing with me where she was just kind of saying, hey, listen, Jace, the whole COVID thing, you need to make more effort with your sister. I don't want that feedback. Like, as in, leave me alone. Like, I'm a good Indian little boy. Like, leave me alone. And so anyway, she gave me this feedback. And I'll never forget, I was like, oh, man, like, as in, I don't like what she's saying right now. But I feel like at that moment, the Holy Spirit just confirmed it. And he wasn't saying, you need to go. She's like going, she's right. Do you know what I mean? Like, as in, as that moment of confirmation, I'm like, oh, I need to do something. It was since then. It was about 2 months ago that she brought this up with me. And from that point onwards, I just booked a day. I booked a time with my sister every week. And we jump on a video call, right? So you might go, oh, this is all about spiritual things. No, these are very practical things. But when you have soft soil, when you have good soil that is being willing to be convicted by the Holy Spirit, change takes place. Here's the thing, right? Some of you are just going, oh, fantastic, great thought. We've heard this all before, but I want to tell you, you might hear a lot of things, but it is when you have the conviction of the Holy Spirit, that's when change happens. That's when change actually takes place. So you may hear worship is a weapon, right? Pastor Lois preached a few weeks ago. You may hear that thought, but I want to tell you, when you have the conviction of the Holy Spirit, I want to tell you, you become someone that says, I am a true worshiper in spirit and in truth. When you hear thoughts, right? When you hear Pastor Mark talking about finances, you won't just go, you probably sent Mark a text, great message, but you didn't apply anything. You might, fire, bro, amazing. In the chat, you were typing heaps. Have you changed your budget yet? Have you changed your tithing situation? Like, as in, or are you still waiting till you earn $1 million so then you'll start tithing? That wasn't the principle he taught. This is the conviction of the Holy Spirit. The conviction of the Holy Spirit brings change. The power of the pause. Are you going to apply it, or is it just a good motto for your life? I want to tell you, apply these principles. Maybe it's the power of submission. And the theory that you had was, oh, listen, I'm going to submit when that guy submits to me. That's not how it works. When the Holy Spirit is doing a work in your life, when you have good soil in you, I want to tell you something. Something amazing takes place and change will happen. Growth is inevitable. Where there is conviction, there is change. And where there is change, there is growth. Do not get confused with condemnation and conviction. God is not condemning you. He is convicting you. The second environment where growth takes place is an environment of community. So it's an environment where you're convicted by the Holy Spirit, but it's also an environment of community. When you are surrounded, when you surround yourself with the right people, you'll grow. And you know this, like as in like Genesis, it's not good for man to be alone. Proverbs 27, as iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24, it says, stir each other up, spur each other on, not to do bad things, but to do great things, to love more people. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, it says, two are better than one, but three are even better than two. Community is even better than two people. Why? Because it is stronger than ever. God has designed you for community. And as I said, you know this. There's probably a next step link coming up right now. Like, you know what I mean? Like, as in, this is what happens. Like, as in, we tell you every week, join a life group. Every week, you have an opportunity to join prayer groups, right? Like, Wednesday morning, we pray together. Sunday morning, before this service, you have an opportunity to join the community. Tonight, right now, tonight, Mark Varghese, he's about to spend time with us. Why do we invite you here? Because we know that it is in community that people grow. It's in community that people actually take next steps. It is in community that we become sharper, like iron sharpens iron. So tonight, like when we invite you here, we're not going, hey, let's all like hold hands and sing Kumbaya. We're going, hey, this is an opportunity for growth. Why? Because community allows us to grow. When you're around the right people, growth takes place. But you know this. I'm about to tell you about a next steps link that tells you to do this. You hear it every week, but yet something holds you back. You know, over the last 2 years, we've run a program called Accelerate, right? And to be honest, this is us inviting people into our staff community, into our leadership community. And 2 years ago, we had 5 or 6 people. This year, we've had 10 or 11 people do Accelerate. And I'll never forget, like, as in, I'll be honest, when COVID happened, I just thought, how's this going to work? So Accelerate is all about someone reorganizing their life and saying, I'm going to sacrifice a day a week for God and commit themselves to Encompass Church for a day a week for the next 12 months, and they just serve God, and they just spend time in our community. And as much as we might call it an internship, a Bible college, an academy, whatever you want to call it, here's the thing, it is all about being in the right community for growth. And people make this amazing decision to say, I want to be in this community. And this year when COVID happened, I just thought, man, maybe these people need to defer. Like, I don't know how this is going to work. And about a few weeks ago, like they kept running and they were in our staff meetings, in book clubs, in Bible courses, all these sorts of things. And a couple of weeks ago, I was in a meeting with them and I started to just ask them some questions about some of the steps that they've taken this year. Like, has growth happened? And I had no idea that this message was about to take place, to be honest. And as people started talking, each of them started to talk about the significant growth that had taken place, how some of them found their purpose. Some of them were sending emails for the very first time. They had found a newfound confidence. Growth took place in the right community. Now, right now you're going, great thought, and you probably don't believe me. So here's something we prepared earlier, where we're going to have a few people share from Accelerate about the growth that has happened in their life. Why don't you check this out?
Doing Accelerate showed me that I can have confidence. Back then, I didn't believe in myself. I thought I couldn't do it. I used to, anything that came up positive, I used to think, nah, you're not good enough. You're not good enough for that job, or you're not good enough for doing that. But now, I feel like I'm the same Diana. I feel like I don't even have bipolar, to be honest with you. God's helped me get through this illness, and just even church, the beautiful people that I know, has helped me as well.
I can remember Wednesday morning, and I came up and said to you, how do you do an email and stuff like that? And like they were doing a thing about yes, and I just didn't want to be a pew warmer, and I felt that God can use old people, so. Lord's been rattling my cage and really out of the comfort zone.
How like we have to just get used to being open around each other, even though we're all pretty much a group of almost strangers at the start. And I didn't think the extent of which you'd have to open up to would go that deep. But I think that's been a big thing. Like, yeah, just being open in front of other people and like just getting to know their stories as well. And there's something that Dita and I talked about on a walk one time, but saying how like even though we're all like different ages, you still feel like you're friends with those people, even though you're all like from in different stages of life and have a different experience and come from different backgrounds and stuff as well. So that's been pretty good.
January 2020, I became a non-smoker. After 27 years of being a smoker, I would definitely have to say that God supernaturally did that for me. Between me and God, He had to do it supernaturally. Left it to my own devices, I would not have wanted to give up. I had stayed too long on this particular mountain, and it was the mountain of grieving. And, you know, Jesse was in his 20s, died of a heart attack. That was my brother's son. So when he had passed away in that year of 2018, I was actually in the middle of doing a diploma of psychology and counselling. Coming back from the funeral back in NZ, I was going to be able to continue it on and finish it, but I couldn't. You give something up in order to take on something, but it was something bigger, something better for you. So I ended up, having to finish it off. Take up the course again, and now I'm doing the homework for it.
I think this year I've really found where my purpose is, and I just really felt like God was growing me in that area and understanding that I really do have a purpose for his kingdom, and that He has had that plan all my life, but it has taken a few steps to get there, and this year has really highlighted that for me.
How amazing was that, right? When you surround yourself with the right people, growth takes place. I am so inspired by that crew. I want to tell you, when I first heard those stories, we were all in tears. Like, as there were people sharing things for the first time, I was like going, I was blown away. I'm so grateful. And I'll be honest, I'm inspired by what I've heard today. Iron sharpens iron. When we surround ourselves with the right people, in the right community, growth takes place. So I'm going to finish where I started. Have you grown? Have you spiritually matured? Not just religious activity here, but I'm talking about, have you become more like Christ? Would your wife tell you that you've become more like Christ? Or are you still dealing with things like you used to? Do you deal with things differently and better? Have you applied what you've learned. And some of you have just gone automatically, yes, of course I have. Maybe you've got a blind spot. Maybe there's a runaway mode in you where, like, you know that area that no one really can come up to you and talk to you about because you kind of give them the dust and mud and don't argue kind of thing? Like, as in, you become unapproachable in a few areas. Maybe you go missing in action when a sensitive area gets brought up with you. I want to tell you, I believe this is the year that you face up and fight. This is the year that you choose to grow. I want to tell you, it is in an environment of conviction. It is an environment of community that growth takes place. But I want to add one more point because it's a three-point sermon and that's how it's supposed to be. Just look at any other service. But here's the thing, one more thing. It takes courage. It's an environment of courage. I want to tell you, these accelerate people, like they sacrificed. It took courage for them to say, I'm committing a life. I'm going to join a new community that's going to kind of put me out of my comfort zone. I've got my problems, warts and all, but I'm going to give this a go. It takes courage to listen to the Holy Spirit, to be soft towards the Holy Spirit and say, I'm not just going to hear his voice and just be convicted. I'm going to do something about it. It takes courage to say, I'm going to reach out to someone and ask for help. It's going to take courage to book that appointment. Going to take courage to do Accelerate next year. It's going to take courage to break out of that cycle, to break out of that habit, to build faith and complete trust in God. But I want to tell you, this is the year. This is the moment that growth takes place. It's an environment of courage. You're going to need to be courageous. A shift is going to need to take place. Would you allow your heart to become good soil this morning? Would you allow your heart to be soft towards the Holy Spirit? Allow him to shift you. Allow him to transform your life. Allow him to do a work, to whisper something in your ear that will encourage you, that will give you the courage that you need to choose growth. You know, one of the most courageous decisions that you could ever make, right, is to give your life to Jesus. Like, let's be honest here. Why is it so courageous? It's not because it's the best decision that you'll ever make, but it's you saying, I'm taking my hands off the steering wheel of my life and I'm handing it over to God. I'm releasing my control. You're a type A personality. You're ticking all the boxes here, but you're kind of going, I'm releasing control. I've tried to fulfill my life with all the hobbies and interests in the world. I've tried to fulfill that God-shaped hole in my heart, but I can't do it. I need something else. Well, you don't need something else. You need someone else. That someone is Jesus. I want to tell you something. Jesus is your answer. No interest, no hobby, no kind of school could ever give you the fulfillment that you need that Jesus can give you today. And I want to tell you, for those of you that are far away, as you were sinning, God died for your sins. Jesus was sent to the cross, the perfect sacrifice, paid for your sin, not only died for our sin, but then he rose again so that you and I could receive eternal life. What does that mean? All that means is that when you and I die, we go to heaven. We live an eternal life because of Jesus, who sacrificed everything for you and I. And I want to tell you, right now, it's not condemnation that you're feeling. It's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that he's asking you to be courageous right now and step out and make the decision to follow Jesus, to say, I'm going to surrender my life and hand it over to Jesus. I believe decisions right now. You're in a moment, a wrestle right now, and decisions need to be made. Courageous decisions to say, I am making this step. A thought's just come to me here is that some of you need to know that when you make a decision for Jesus, when you decide to become a follower of Jesus, I want to tell you, I know stories where addictions have fallen off. Like literally, people's lives were transformed. It was an accelerated moment of growth for their life. So not only did they receive eternal life, but the smoking addiction, the pornography addiction, all those things just came off like chains. I want to tell you something. Today is the day that you give your life, you surrender your life to Jesus. And all you got to do is just repeat after me. Wherever you are, whoever you're with right now, everyone in that room, everyone that is with you right now is going to repeat these words after me. And we're going to commit our lives to Jesus. Dear Lord Jesus, today I invite you into my heart. Today, I surrender my life to you. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Lord, this day I choose to walk with you. I choose to talk with you. And I choose to grow with you. in your name. Amen. You know, what an incredible decision you've made. You know, with all the buttons and the next steps links that come up right now, all we want to know is that you've made the decision that so that we could actually walk with you. We don't want to just talk about this idea of growth, but we actually want to grow with you. We want to do this journey with you in this season. And so Teresa, Jinu, Nithya, some different people in our team would love to reach out with you, start the conversation and be able to actually walk with you in this incredible decision that you've made. So right now, church, we're going to keep singing a song. And I just believe that the Holy Spirit is going to be able to do a great work in you. So would you allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you as we sing? And I just believe that God is going to reveal something to you. Maybe something that you need to face up to, that you need courage for, that there's a softening in your heart. You will face up and you will embrace the essential business of growth. God bless.
Amen. Sing. And oh, Holy Spirit, burn like a fire. Oh, consume me, consume me. Here in your presence, Lord, I surrender. Through your glory, for your
of God, you know, on a Sunday morning. You know, how awesome was that message from Pastor Jane? So encouraging, the essential business of growth. You know, God's heart for you and I is to grow. You know, can I encourage you and can I challenge you this morning? As Pastor Jay said, you know, place yourself in an environment of conviction and in a community and see yourself grow. You know, get accountable, you know, reach out to a pastor and a mentor, you know, be part of a serving team or a life group. You know, so good. Thank you so much, Pastor Jace. If you made a decision to follow Jesus this morning, a big, massive congratulations to you. It's the best decision you'll ever make. And can I encourage you to take a next step and to connect with us so that we as a team can equip you with all the essential things that you need to grow in your faith and in your relationship with Jesus. So you'll see the prompts on the screen. Go to the next steps a link. You know, don't just be an online viewer, be a part of our church community. Okay, that's all for today, but just a quick reminder, tonight, Conversations 2.0, our very last one with Pastor Mark Varughese, 7:30. If you're not registered, get yourself registered. And also, for those of you who are partners of our church, annual general meeting is happening at 12:10 p.m. You should have received an email and a Zoom link. Please be there and let us know if you can't make it. And lastly, eKids program is happening soon as well. So kids, make sure you stick around. Have an amazing week. We'll see you again next week. Hi guys, welcome back to eKids. How was the second week back at school? I'm sure it was fantastic. My name is Naomi and I am your host today. Now, are you ready to start a new topic today? Today, we are learning a new topic called patience. Can you say it up? Can you repeat it after me? Say it out loud and type it in the chat box. That's right, patience. But before we get into today's message, We are going to play a game called, drum rolls, What's in the Box? Okay, so this is how we are going to play the game. I have four different boxes here with me with four different items in each of these boxes. So what you are going to do is you are going to guess what the items are. I know it sounds a little bit tricky, but don't worry. I'm here to help you out and give you some clues. So are you ready? Let's go. Okay. Box number one. The clue for box number one is you kick it, you pass it, and you also mark it. What do you think is in box number one? Are you ready? It's a footy ball. Well done, everyone that guessed it right. Okay, moving on to box number two. Box number two, here is your clue. Complete this rhyme. Jesus loves me, yes, I know, for the dot, dot, dot tells me so. So what do you think is in box number two? Are you ready, guys? It's a Bible. Well done. You guys are too clever. All right. Are we ready for box number three? Box number three. Okay. So, the clue is, this item is soft, this item is white, and it is also very, very thin. I use it a lot when I sneeze. What do you think item number three is? Are you ready? Are you ready for me to reveal it? It is tissue paper. Well done, guys. I feel like this is too easy for you. All right, are we ready for the last one? Last but not least. So, the clue is fedoras, sombreros, and caps are types of, let's see if you guys know this one, hats. Well done, guys. You all did so well. That's a wrap for today's game. I hope you had fun. Now, it's time for us to worship God. So, why don't you turn up the volume, sing as loud as you can, and lift your hands up as we worship our awesome God.
Before the day I took a breath, you had a plan for my every step. You promised to always be by my side. I believe that you are the way, you are the truth, you are the lie. So I sing this to you. Every day. I will believe in everything that you say.
in the garage, in the car. Want to know why? Because this is where me and my family agreed to meet. My dad was like, everybody, get in the car so we can leave for the movies in 10 minutes. It's been 13 minutes since he said that. Do you see anyone in this car? I love the movies. It's been 6 months since I've gone. The popcorn, the big screen, and previews. I know it sounds weird, but I love the previews. Getting to see what's coming next, it's honestly one of my favorite parts. But guess what? You get there late, and you know what you've missed? The previews! So here I am, waiting 4 minutes later for my family than they should have been? I mean, how can they do this to me? They know I love the previews. Where is everyone? If we get there late, we're gonna miss the previews!
What's up, e-kids? Good morning. I hope you're having a good day at home and in your school. Today, we're gonna learn a story about patience. I have to ask you a question. Have you ever waited for something for such a long time? Like, for example, you're going on a trip, going on a holiday, and you have to sit on a plane for such a long time, maybe 5 to 6 hours, just sitting still. It can be hard and challenging, isn't it? Or when you're in a theme park and the line is just super long, and unfortunately, it takes a long time for you to have a go at like a certain ride. It's a very, very challenging, and waiting can sometimes be quite hard and annoying and just make you uncomfortable. Sometimes when we have to wait for a long time, we sometimes lose our patience. We just blew it. We throw tantrums, we throw a fit, we get angry, and sometimes we have to get in trouble for losing our temper. If this is something that happens to you, or if you experience something like this, then you can relate to our Bible story. This is about a people of Israel, or what we call the Israelites. The Israelites are God people. These people actually love God. They want to follow God, and they actually promise God that they will do anything to make God happy. One day, the Israelites is in the desert. They were led by a leader called Moses and his brother Aaron. Moses has to go on top of the mountain to talk to God. I know it's quite weird, but during the Old Testament, we cannot talk to God anytime or anywhere. So during that time, God wanted to talk to Moses to give him a message so that he can relay this message to the people of Israel. So before Moses leave, he told the people, I want you to follow this very important instruction. While I'm on top of the mountains, I want you to wait patiently for my return. I want you to follow Aaron and all of us. When I get back, we're gonna hear the message of God. Unfortunately, Moses has to be in the mountain for quite a long time. He's not gonna return tomorrow. It will take days, weeks, or probably months. Now, the problem is the Israelites, they start to become very, very impatient, and they start to complain. They get angry at Moses, to Aaron, and to everyone. They're like, when is Moses gonna come back? Is he ever gonna return? So they just complain and throw a big tantrums. So guess what happened? Because they are impatient, what they do is they requested Aaron to create a new God for them. That's correct. They wanted a fake God. So the Israelites know that Moses is actually on top of the mountain talking to the real God. But unfortunately, because they are impatient, they just wanted a new God now. So they demanded with Aaron, and because they are impatient and Aaron gets tired of people complaining and whining all the time, he gave in. Aaron gathered a lot of gold among the Israelites' people, like golden necklace or earrings or bracelet. And out of this collection of gold, they actually made a gold statue. The gold statue is now their new god. Have you got any guess of what is this statue look like? You're gonna think it's funny, but it's actually a golden cow. Correct. Now the Israelites got a new God in the form of a golden cow because they are impatient. It's funny, but during that time, the Israelites people actually love this new God. They love this golden cow. They sing praises to this God. They dance, they party, and they just worship this God and forgetting about the real good God in heaven. Now, in the middle of all the party and the gatherings and the happenings, Moses arrived from the mountain. He saw what the people are doing, and Moses also see this new fake God, the golden cow. What do you think Moses feel and how he reacted? He actually becomes very, very, very angry. He is so disappointed with the people. I told you to be patient and wait for me. Now, because he is so angry, he crushed the golden statue and turned it into a powder, like a little dust. Mix it with water, and make the people drink it. Now, the story ended really, really badly. It could have been a different ending. It could be a happy one, something that we can learn from. But it's a disaster instead, only because the people are impatient and they couldn't wait without complaining. I know that sometimes waiting can be very, very hard, but always remember that God wants us to be patient and wait for His instruction. He wants us to be patient with people around us, because if you're patient with the people around you, then you're showing them love. Always remember that if you're tempted to become impatient and start to complain and whine, always remember that God loves all those people He placed around you. He loves your parents, He loves your friends, He loves your teacher, He loves your brothers and your sister. So you have to be patient with them, because like what I said a while ago, if you show them patience, then you are showing them love. So the bottom line for today's story is wait without complaining. Can you say that again with me? Wait without complaining. All right. I know that patience can be very hard and like what I said, very challenging. And even like the best people who loves God, like the Israelites, can fall into the temptation of whining and complaining. But we can always do things if God is helping us. This is something that is beyond us. If this is something that we cannot do on our own, then we have to pray to God and ask for wisdom to make wise choices. I want everyone to close their eyes. Close your eyes. Bow your head, and we're going to pray together. Dear Jesus, thank you, Lord, for always being with us. Thank you for forgiving us if we mess up and we become impatient. I pray that you will give us the wisdom and the patience to show love to everyone around us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Don't be proud at all. Be completely gentle. Be patient. Put up with one another in love. Ephesians 4:2.
Do not be proud. Don't be proud at all. Do not be proud. Don't be proud at all.
Be completely gentle. Be completely gentle.
Be patient. Be patient. Put up with one another in love.
Don't be proud at all. Be completely gentle. Be patient. Put up with one another in love. Ephesians 4:2.
It's so hard to wait on something you want right now, but I'm not going to be a complainer. I'm sure my family isn't purposely trying to make me miss the previews. I know they love me and they wouldn't do that to me. Something must have happened when they were getting ready that I don't know about, so I'm going to choose patience and not complain. I can always check out the new previews when they come out online. So what about you? Can you wait without complaining? When you find yourself waiting this week and you will have to wait on something, choose patience instead of complaining. We can do this. Yes, I hear my family. We're about to head out. I'll see you guys next time.
Hi there. Are you tuning into Church at Home for the first time? Maybe a friend or family member invited you. Maybe you found us online. Or maybe you clicked on this by accident. No matter how you came to church today, we believe it is no coincidence you're here. And we would love to connect with you. Head to our website to find out who we are. Join a life group to experience connection like never before. Jump on our social media to keep up to date with the life of our church. Or fill out a next steps form so that our team can reach out to you during the week. We can't wait to meet you.